Diego. One of the big pushes was in 1870, 1871. They were talking about bringing one through Yuma to connect up with a railroad from Marshall, Texas. But the financial crisis of the 1870s pretty much wiped that out. So it wasn't until 1880 that Thomas Nickerson and the ATNSF actually agreed to help. And so the goal was to build from San Diego to a point near the Nevada border and connect up with something coming from the east. To get the railroads to come into San Diego, there was 10,000 acres and one half of all the unsold city lots in National City was given to the railroad, $10,000 in cash. And there was some individual land grants that were given and some government lands. So this is the route that we'll talk about from that period. So the surveys began in October of 1880. J.O. Osgood was the engineer, chief engineer. And the National City to Temecula had four surveyors working there. That were Wheeler, Fred Paris, Copeland, and Varshaw. So at the time, when people say that Fred Paris selected this route, Fred Paris was not an employee of the railroad. Fred Paris was a contractor. He was just a surveyor. And there were four others. Now, he did survey a portion of the route, but not all of the route through the train. When the route for this railroad was never specifically in the charter, it was never specifically stated as to where that route would actually be. In fact, there was a lot of discussions as to where that route would be. When the topographic engineers came through in the 1854, they avoided Temecula Canyon. They knew there was a route that they could come down from San Gregorian Pass, come down probably through Rainbow Canyon, and then over to the mission at the San Luis Rey. And they recognized that the canyon was not something that they wanted to actually deal with. There was a little town of Bonzal. They actually offered Osgood to change the name of that town to Osgood. There was other route selections that we get on further north that were a little bit iffy. When it got to Elsinore, it could either go through Box Springs, or it could go a little further to the west and go up through Riverside. The railroad asked the people in Riverside, if you want it to come through that way, you need to come up with the extra $175,000 that's going to come through and give us the land. Riverside couldn't do that, so the route was selected through Box Springs because it was cheaper. This is an 1882 railroad map. And these are the mile markers that were put on it. So another one that just came up, I just found this out a few weeks ago, as to where were the tracks actually going. These are two maps of Temecula, 1882 and 1884. And in this one, you can see this is Margarita Creek, and the railroad. The railroad is on the east side of the creek. This is 84 one. You can see that the railroad is on the west side. The question comes is this, was the railroad ever on the other side of the creek? There's at least one person in Temecula that says it was. However, the tracks come out of the canyon on the west side. It seems crazy to me that they crossed over the creek and then had to cross back over the creek again. It's also possible that this map was made, I don't really know whether the creek could have changed during that period of time, whether this map was just a map that was made and never really implemented. I don't know. Both of them were made by Fred Paris. So, one of those questions that no one knew those answers to. Okay, so now, this railroad was kind of funny, and every bit of material that was used to construct this railroad was brought into the port in San Diego and National City by ships. So this road was built from National City up to the north. Why would they do that? Why would they got to all of the costs of bringing all of that equipment around the horn or across the difference? Well, it's because the other two railroads were owned by the Big Four, and they said there's no way there's going to be a third transcontinental railroad, and the other two railroads refused to ship any of the equipment or rails. So the rails that came in from Germany and Belgium came around the horn. The locomotives, which were built in Boston, came around that way. So everything, all the equipment was brought into San Diego or Nashville City and built north from there. So, in the there were different engineers in charge of building different sections of the railroad and different components. A.L. Mills was the engineer in charge back to the canyon. There were about 20 different contractors working on this line from National City to Colton. These are a few of the contractors that were there. Now, there were between 2,000 and 3,000 workers. No real records that we can find, but somewhere between 800 and 1,500 were Chinese. Again, no pay stubs that we can find. And the gangs were assigned to the specific sections of the road. So you had a different contractor or different gangs doing different things. You had one doing grading and blasting, another one doing track laying, another one building bridges, another one putting in the telegraph. And company carpenters typically constructed most of the depots. The rest of this was done by contractors. So, in talking about the Chinese labor, you had a labor procurement, labor contractors. Each gang had their own foreman. They did a lot of the blasting and grading. They did a lot of the work in the 7 miles of the cliffs through the canyon. Now, here's a question. I don't know if any of you have ever read some of the history on the railroad, especially with the Chinese workers, but they talk about them swinging off of the cliffs in baskets to drill the holes to blast out the railroad lines. That's written up in probably 300 textbooks and I don't know how many other articles. There's a big argument going on today that that's a myth, that did not happen, that they did not swing over the sides on those baskets, that there was actually no need to do that. So the workers, the Chinese workers back before 1865, they really weren't considered good workers. They could be cooks, laundrymen, they could be gardeners. But then after the 12,000 Chinese worked on the Central Pacific, a lot of the work on the railroads in the western United States was done by the Chinese. But in the 1880s, when this railroad was started, there was only a few Chinese living in the San Diego area. But some of the San Diego businessmen remembered a Chinese man by the name of Ah Quin, who was working at that time in San Francisco. And Ah Quin was bilingual, or closely bilingual. So they actually contacted Ah Quin and said, hey, do you want to come down here to San Diego and start getting laborers for us to come in to work on the road? He arrived in October and began recruiting immediately. Now, Ah Quin, at this time frame, he didn't have a construction contract. But he recruited laborers. And one article that I read, newspaper article, said that he was paid $13 per Chinese worker, including the transportation cost to get them there. So if he hired 2,000 Chinese workers in that two-year period of time, he became a very wealthy man, which he in fact did. So this is Ah Quin, and this is his wife, Susie. Not this Susie. This is Susie Castle, who's a professor at University of San Marcos. And we know quite a bit about what happened in 84 in the reconstruction of the railroad after the flood, because Ah Quin kept a diary. Mm-hmm. His diary started in 1884. Dr. Castle has actually, his diary is mostly in English, but some Chinese. And Dr. Castle has actually translated those Chinese into English, of which she sent me about 600 pages of the diary to read.
600.
But this describes the work that was done in rebuilding the railroad after one of the floods. So, So the Chinese workers, they will pay a little bit less than the white workers, maybe. There's no pay records, but typically they were. They had a major camp at Fallbrook. They had a major camp at Temecula. Each gang had their own cook. The Chinese foreman was in charge of each gang. They all purchased their supplies from Ma Quinn. This is how he got rich. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's an interesting thing in 1881. We had all these Chinese workers that were working on the railroad. They just come in by ship. They got on the railroad and they started working. And there was a law in San Diego, I think in 1880, that charged every bale a road tax. So the county was a little short on money. We're talking about being short on money. Scott, the county was a little short on money, so they decided to do for Chinese mails, and they should pay the road tax. So they sent the sheriff out to Temecula Canyon in the rail to collect all the road tax from the Chinese. So blasting and grading, and this is kind of interesting, is that there's very little documentation on the Chinese workers. You don't have really, I can't find any photographs. This is the only photograph that has been attributed to Chinese workers on the California Southern Railroad. This was actually down close to Oceanside or something. No other photographs have I located. So talked about the blasting in the canyon. This is one of the blast holes that's there. There were some students here at the Ecological Reserve last summer. And they walked down the canyon and measured some of the distances between these blast holes. They were between 8 and 10 feet is what they measured in many of them. So this is taken from where you guys are standing this morning. We're going to look at this rock right here a little bit later. But the blasting in the canyon actually resulted in quite a few injuries. And there were a number of Chinese workers who threatened to quit and go back to San Francisco, where they would maybe make less money, but their work wasn't quite as dangerous. this contribution, I mean, we know about the Chinese on the Central Pacific, but the workers on the other railroads in this area, there's just very little documentation that I found on. This is bridges. There were a number of bridges over the Santa Margarita River. I don't think you're going to walk downstream this far today, but this is, you can almost see this from standing up here. This is one of the bridge abutments. And Bruce actually has brought along a series of air photographs. If you haven't looked at them, they're 1928 air photographs of which he's been able to trace the old railroad bed, and therefore know where the bridges actually crossed the river. So there were a number of different bridges crossing the river. So this is the photograph that Beth showed of this little waterfall. This is the same waterfall taken last year. This is the old railroad bed that you'll walk along. Another interesting thing about history is that if you're not there, you have to believe what you read, or not believe what you read. This train picture shows up in three or four historical society files. It shows up in three or four different magazines and articles. It's variously described as the Oddfellow excursion train in 1882, of which the Oddfellow train in the newspapers only has five railroad cars. This is also described as an excursion train in Temecula Canyon. It's also described as an excursion train in Box Canyon. So I think most people that I've talked to believe that it is in Temecula Canyon. It probably is an excursion train since there's people standing outside of it here. But it's probably not the Oddfellow excursion train. Temecula Train Depot. This is actually the first depot in Temecula was actually a boxcar. And I'm not quite sure when this one was built. But at first, they only had a boxcar there. It also had a post office, just like the one down in Fallbrook. So this is the Temecula. Here's the boxcars, the depot, trains running over here on this side of the street. So looking at the train schedule, the southbound train schedule, It took about 3 hours and 20 minutes from Temecula to San Diego. The averaging at 72 miles is about 20 miles an hour. Temecula to Fallbrook, 11 miles in 40 minutes, you run about 16 miles an hour through the canyon. And then Fallbrook to San Diego, about 30 minutes, you run about 22 miles an hour. Now there's some discussion, I mean, in the train, going south, you could almost coast down the canyon. Coming up the canyon, I read if you had a heavy headwind, that you had trouble getting up the tracks. This was a pretty steep track. It had grade in places of over 2.2, and railroads did not like to run on that big of a grade. So some of the passenger comments that were going through the train was the scenery was simply magnificent. Cars almost touching the rocky sides. Little brooks and rivulets running down rocky channels, and one was surely the last plane touched by the mayor's hand, and he built the full job. So, let's talk a little bit then about the floods. There was major flooding in 1811, 1815, 1825, 1841. 49, 62 was described by an old Indian at Pala as a very, very large flood. 84, the canyon was flooded. 91, the canyon was flooded. And then again in 1960, the canyon was flooded. So, by the way, this is another photograph of that waterfall. This is not a real flood. This is a heavy rain, but not one of the big floods. So in 84, I have 20 to 40 inches of rainfall in the watershed. Bruce said 18. Scott said 18.
In Fallbrook, yeah.
In Fallbrook. So various places reported different amounts of rain. On February 1, you had landslides and boulders in the canyon. On February the 3rd, the train couldn't get through. Off wind. Who recorded in his book that it was Brook in Temecula Valley. I said he spoke English, and he did, but spelling was February 14th, the tracks and all the bridges were washed out. Water was reported to be 26 feet deep in the canyon, the ties and trash out to the ocean. Now, my question really is, were the ties and tracks that were in Temecula Canyon, were they carried all the way out to the ocean? Or were the ocean, the ties that they saw in the ocean, were those washed out from Oceanside? Because all those tracks were washed out too. Yeah. Seems kind of difficult to me to take those ties that far. Maybe they did. I would have thought there would have been enough brush and stuff to catch them. So now, Quinn was actually hired as a contractor during